Yes. Hello. So
next speaker, Florence Smith Nicholls. I'm very excited for your talk. PhD student in games, Queen Mary University in London. But before that, a field archaeologist and heritage consultant. And I love when we get people with different kinds of expertise at Roguelike. So I think just take it away about object biographies. I can't wait.
Okay. Well, hello, everyone. Hello from not so sunny London, where I am at the minute. And I'm going to be talking to you today about object biographies, an archaeological approach to PCG. And I already kind of had a bit of an introduction, but I should probably talk about my own biography as well. So I worked as an archaeologist in London for 6 years. But while I was doing that, I also did independent research into the archaeological study of video games, which is also known as archaeogaming. And that can take various different forms. It could be looking at how heritage is presented in games, with, you know, Lara Croft being the obvious example, or it could be actually treating games themselves as artifacts. Or it could be archaeological approaches to video games, which is kind of what I'm going to be looking at with my PhD that I'm doing at the minute in game AI, which is titled Procedural Generation as Generative Archaeology at Queen Mary University of London. But how am I going to do this? How am I going to bring archaeology and PCG together? Well, one idea I've had so far is to bring in this concept of object biographies from archaeology. So probably kind of, as you can tell from the term, it's very much about trying to trace the life cycle of an object. And the idea really behind this is that we're not just looking at, say, the object as it might be excavated, but kind of the whole different kind of like network of interactions that it may be a part of. So if we take a chair as an example, we could look at, well, what materials is it made from? Where does that wood come from? What kind of craftspeople would have made that? What kind of tools would they have used? Was it always used as a chair? Was it perhaps reused and became a different kind of object altogether? Who owned it? Was it exchanged? And eventually, was it deposited in the ground as rubbish, or even, you know, did it end up in a museum, as some things do? And of course, there are various different games that arguably already have object biographies, including roguelikes. One perhaps obvious example, and I'm sure many people will be aware of, is Caves of Cud. For example, Caves of Cud has kind of important figures in the game are sultans. And if sultans have these important items called relics, when they die, those will go into their reliquary. And I've got an example on screen here of a blade which has a particular kind of decoration of sapphires on it, which might potentially relate to its history. So this is just one example of how you might see object biographies in roguelikes already. But I really want to kind of delve even deeper into this idea and what we could potentially do with it. And the way I'm going to start to explore this is with an existing game. Some of you might know Mike Cook. He's made a very short game as part of a game jam called Nothing Beside Remains. And in the game, you're a person who's found this ruined village in the middle of the desert, and you're essentially kind of going around and interacting with different objects, and different text will be displayed, and it uses a kind of like replacement grammar system to do that. And the objects that you see and what kind of descriptions you get depend on three different factors that may have led to the ending of the village. That could be wildlife, it could be environmental factors, or it could be overpopulation leading to starvation. So that's how the game works as it stands. And I just want to have a brief interlude at this point, strangely enough, with this poem by Ogden Nash. And the reason why I've got this here is because, as you might have noticed, Nothing Beside Remains, the title of Mike's game, this comes from a quite famous poem called Ozymandias by Percy Shelley. But I really like Ogden Nash's version of this poem because it's kind of like a satire of it. And something that I'm really interested in with tinkering with this game is kind of potentially doing some kind of satire of this idea of, like, you know, the lone traveler who discovers this mysterious kind of ruin and, you know, the kind of implications and connotations of that, especially as an archaeologist, because a lot of times when we have games which are about discovering archaeology, it's very based on very kind of pop culture and honestly colonial ideas of what it means to be an archaeologist. So that's why I kind of wanted to just take a moment to have that poem there. And I think whoever kind of did the ordering of the talks for this was just a genius, because I feel like all of our talks really feed into each other. And I think what Shaveen was saying about like unreliable narrators and roguelikes is really interesting, because that's something that I'm also super interested in as well. Because as I started to think about what I could do with object biographies in a game like Nothing Beside Remains, I was really thinking about the inherent subjectivity of not just the objects themselves, but also the people creating the object biography, and that could be the player themselves. So what I'm thinking about is having three potential kind of like roles for the protagonists that you could have upon playing, which will give you different kind of perspectives on the objects you find to kind of emphasize this inherent subjectivity. And I could have had like an archaeologist as one of these classes, instead I have tourist, poet, curator. But I didn't want to do that because I was kind of worried that it might seem that would be like the good one, right? But actually, an archaeologist and a looter are not necessarily mutually exclusive, unfortunately. And, you know, out of the tourist, poet and curator, none of these are like the quote unquote good one. And they're all kind of overlapping. And I thought it was interesting to have roles that kind of as well link back to the original poem where you meet a traveler. And of course, the poet is one of the roles as well. And I've been kind of influenced by quite a few games in this line of thinking. So, for example, Disco Elysium, as I'm sure many of you are aware, has the infamous horrific necktie, for example, which can talk to you and give its own kind of opinions on events. And it's this kind of, I'm really interested in the objects in the game being actually able to speak directly to you and having their own point of view on things that happened. And I've also been influenced a lot by Heaven's Vault, because that has this translation mechanic in which, depending on previous translations that you've made, it will influence how you interpret new bits of writing that you find later on. So it's this idea that kind of inferences that you've already made will change how you respond to new information. I wanted to give kind of a more in-depth example of how this might actually work in practice in the game. So let's say, for example, the protagonist you have is a tourist and they're really interested in like the disaster tourism of this ruined village. And you come across a book, which is an object, which like all objects in this game is very subjective. It has its own point of view on things that have happened. And because this particular village was destroyed by wild animals, the book will have had pages ripped out of it in order for the animals to make a nest. And the order in which you interact with the book pages and the book itself, because it's this kind of fragmented object at that point, will change kind of the object biography that you sort of construct and the text that's generated. But to kind of link this more clearly back to the roguelike concept, one thing I'm really interested in is this idea that with each kind of village that's generated, there is a sense of permadeath, because it's really just kind of like an exploration game and there's no real sort of fail state. You just keep going until, you know, you're satisfied with your experience. But, you know, each time a village is generated, it'll never be quite the same again. And with the original Nothing Beside Remains game, it was very much designed to be played once. But I'd really like for this version for it to actually be the idea that you play it several times, and that potentially previous villages generated kind of like data, or maybe some of the entries from that will like feed back into the generation of new villages, so that maybe there can be a sense that different villages and different objects across playthroughs are referencing each other. And yeah, that's all I have for now. But please do get in contact with me if you have any more questions or thoughts or ideas about this. And yeah, please check out Knives and Paintbrushes, which is the research collective that I'm a part of. Thanks very much.
Excellent. I love it. I love a Disco Elysium reference. I had to grab. I have a horrific necktie. but yeah, no, I think that that's wonderful. And I will say for people in chat, we actually do have a little bit of time for questions, if there are any that people want to throw out there. But yeah, I love that idea of kind of layered history and the carrying over. I know I enjoy, you know, if one plays Dwarf Fortress long enough and actually like abandons some forts and keeps going, then you, like, that's one example. I know you get a little bit of the potential for the reference across playthroughs, which I think is kind of almost an element of meta progression that is not so much as explored.
Yeah, that, I think, yeah, that's the kind of thing I'm really interested in. And Dwarf Fortress is, yeah, one of the things at the top of my list to play, because I haven't quite, yeah, I haven't got to playing it yet, because it always kind of intimidated me a little bit. But I've had conversations with people and about it and how, yeah, it has potentially object biographies in it. So, yeah, really love
to see that. Yeah, I know it's, I think from, 2017, it was a while ago, there's a talk from, it was a conference at Leiden University on archaeology in Dwarf Fortress, and I remember it was cool. There was some of the, like, Dwarf Fortress involves minting of coins, which have iconography on them, which then, like, the historical record and finding coins and the kind of history. So, yeah, that was a great talk. I might try and find it and drop a link somewhere.
Yeah, thank you. I want to see that.
Yeah, one question, which, you know, may or may not be something that you know about. There was some discussion in chat about Ultima Ratio.
Right, which, yes. Yeah.
Yeah. As another game with kind of this historian sociologist background, is that something that you have any thoughts on?
Yeah, I'm really, really interested in that game. And there's actually a paper that I think Mark Johnson is the developer of that game. And he wrote a paper called something like a qualitative procedural generation, I think. And that's been really helpful for me, because he talks about kind of this idea of rather than thinking about, say, like the procedural generation of buildings, spaces like that, but thinking about, oh, can we procedurally generate more abstract concepts like religion? And then if you do that, how would that affect the material culture that's generated in that world? So yeah, really, really good example. Yeah.
Yeah. Which again brings us, I think, back to Dwarf Fortress as so often is the case, because I know that like adding religion and things has been going on there. And now, you know, there's the generated forms of art and worship and poetry that comes in. Very interesting. I think it's also fascinating, the idea of like objects being able to carry information, and you know, like the quote in terms of taking like an antique approach, because I think that I've seen in the space of MMOs and like largely social games sometimes discussion of object biographies and histories, because you do get that like provenance of sometimes an item that's been passed around or involved in like events in an MMO sense, which I do think I've seen not come up as much in games. But roguelikes, we actually sometimes put the playtime in to be able to maybe have time to generate that history in a way that, you know, in 20 hours you might not be able to.
Yeah, that's a really good point. That's super interesting as well, like that idea of almost like heirlooms that are passed between like players, and like they generate history not through like the in-game fictional history, but like, guess it's like a bit of a weird one, but like, yeah, through the history, like the relationships between players themselves. Yeah
and the historical events, at least, of like, this is the sword used to slay the dragon for the first time, which is fascinating. And I mean, now I'm just spitballing, but it's like, I think there's something interesting that too, where there's kind of the world within the history within the world, and then the history between multiple players of a world, and like how that can build, which is interesting. You know, not that we need to add a like networked back end to most roguelikes, but which is really fascinating, because I think also I'm interested in like the storytelling element of history too, of like the interpretation and how that gets applied. Like roguelikes, I think, have a strong tradition of at least storytelling and talking about the things that happen, and that helps like narrativize and
definitely.
Excellent. Well, yeah, lots of food for thought, lots of discussion in chat. Thank you so much for making it and for a wonderful lightning talk.